Hashtag own voice. Let's have a look. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this episode of Heiser Says. I thought we'd start the day off with something interesting from own voice, a Twitter trend that I haven't heard of. I've got my stein of coffee. I hope you're ready to watch a video before work. So this is from Slate, and it was shared by Jordan Peterson. So Wolves, a YA, which is Young Author Sensitivity Reader, just think about that. I'm going to keep that in the back of your mind. Watched his own community kill his debut novel before it was even released. Okay? Sensitivity Reader. It seems like something out of Gulag Archipelago, or out of, Papers, Please, to be honest. So, until recently, Kosoko Jackson was considered an expert in the trapdoors of identity-related rhetoric. Jackson worked as a sensitivity reader for major publishers of young adult fiction, a job that entails reading manuscripts and flagging them for problematic content. So he's a censor, essentially. His own debut novel, A Place for Wolves, was promoted as an own voices, hashtag own voices book, a hashtag attached approvingly to books which the author shares a particularly marginalized identity with his subject. Okay, so just, we've got a sensitivity reader who's behind the own voices hashtag, and just the idea of having this hashtag in itself is quite scary to me, to be honest, because it is attributing identity politics to the legitimacy of what someone can write. So apparently fiction is out the window. Jackson is black and queer. Okay, so he's got two. Too bad he wasn't Muslim, because then he'd have the trifecta. The trifecta of identity politics, at least in America. He believed that, for example, women shouldn't profit from writing gay men's stories, as he tweeted last year. He was part of a small and informal but intense online community that scolds writers who run afoul of these values in their work or online. So they're morality police. They're online Twitter mobs. Now Jackson has been demonized by the community he once helped police. I've got a clap for that one. That's fantastic. It just shows you the left are eating themselves. They will eat themselves. It's nuts. A Place for Wolves, Jackson's first novel, was scheduled for publication later this month. The romantic thriller set in the late 1990s during the Kosovo War follows a relationship between two American teen boys. The book looked poised to success. It received several early starred reviews, which influenced library purchases and bookstore placements, and had been named a kids' indie next pick, suggesting an early interest from independent booksellers. Or, just to step aside and add some commentary here from myself, is that all I know about bookstores, I learned from Black Books. Thumbs up if you're a Black Books fan and you like drinking wine. Back to the article. Last week, however, Jackson released a statement addressed to the book community that apologized for the problematic representation and historical insensitivities in his novel. He wrote that he'd asked his publisher, Source Books, to withdraw the book from publication. Source Books quickly complied. Now, in some ways, a part of me feels sorry for this guy, because this is a red pill that I hope he will learn from and realize that this entire community, this entire way of restricting people's ability to produce work and tying it to your identity and all this BS, political correctness, identity politics, culture war rubbish that they're building these online profiles for and then trying to leverage it to generate a book, which is fine. I mean, that's a rule. You get fans, and then if you do another project, you share that with them. And the problem is, his fans aren't really the supportive type or the people in his community. They just are tearing him down. So let's have a look at the backlash. The backlash seems to have begun on February 22nd with a long review posted to the community review site Goodreads. a favorite site of young author agonistes, so people who are agonizing in a combat, in a struggle, valiant warriors and heroes of this movement. I have to be absolutely effing honest with everybody here. The review opened in the hyperbolic voice of its genre. I've never been so disgusted in my life, she objected to the book's use of a recent genocide as a backdrop to romance, the way some early fans fetishized it as a cute gay love story, that it was not written by a Muslim. Yeah, see, I told you, he didn't have the trifecta, and that it centers privileged Americans, and that the villain is an ethnic Albanian, among other concerns. Just look at how they've deconstructed the novel, and then they've pulled it apart and attacked it by all these different things. So in its way, it's kind of beautiful how they can really just pull something apart and destroy it, utterly destroy it. Are you able to confidently justify supporting this book despite all of the above? Despite the harm it can and will do to real people. How will it do harm? How will a book do harm? She asked in conclusion. The reviewer, nonetheless, gave the book 2 stars out of 5 because it was own voices and well done. Because it was own voices, you get a star. And because it was well done, you get a star. But he wasn't a Muslim, so he didn't get that star. They fetishized it, so he didn't get that star. And it was an ethnic Albanian, so he didn't get that star. When adding some commentary here, when I was at high school, there was a book that we had to read. It was Looking for Alibrandi. And that was just a coming-of-age story of a teenage girl. And, you know, as a teenage boy, I had no problem reading that book or enjoying it. It was quite a good one. They even made a movie of it, I think. So the whole own voices movement, I just think it's pathetic. It really is just pathetic PC identity politics grab at trying to create something out of nothing so they have justification to tear apart this work. And, you know, it sounds like it was a good story. I've got no problem with a, you know, a cute gay love story. I'm sure some people would like it. There's nothing wrong with writing this type of stuff. It could have been a next masterwork. You never know. But now, because of this rubbish, this own voices, this postmodern deconstruction of the work, and it's disappearing. The criticism snowballed from there, with other readers chiming in. How could you take a beautiful LGBTQ love story and S on genocide victims like that? One asked on Twitter, of course. It was on Twitter. Heidi Heilig, an author who has participated in many online skirmishes and provided a positive blurb for Jackson's book, hastily revised her Goodreads review of A Place for Walls. She suggested the book's context may have changed since she read an early draft, apologized to those who'd been hurt by my blurb, and promised to work harder. Oh, wow. Wow. See, this is the problem. They care about this community's opinion. And there was recently an article published in the news, and I'll probably look at it later today, about a academic here in Australia who was like had a couple hundred Twitter profiles and was using those to send different messages to influence businesses here in Australia for his social justice politicking. So wouldn't it be sad if it was only one pathetic purple-haired person with their cats in their living room, depressed, sending these tweets? Seeing the momentum within his own community turn against him, Jackson apparently decided it was better to self-cancel than to be cancelled. This is the second time this year that a young author-writer has made the same calculation. In January, another first-time author, Emily Wenzel, asked her publisher to pull her to-be-released fantasy novel Blood Air because of early reader critiques about racial insensitivity. The novel featured a storyline about slavery and a character who some readers interpret as black, who dies so a white character can live. Zhao explained in her statement that as a Chinese immigrant to the United States, she was inspired by trafficking and labor issues in Asia, but apologized nonetheless for causing pain. Oh, wow. Arja Hoggard broke down the controversy in detail for Slate. Jackson had participated in the online pylon. So he's copying. Okay, so I don't feel sorry for him. He has done the same bloody thing, piling on to this poor woman, and now he's copying it. In many ways, this is terrible. The fact that people are using this to stop written work. I mean, sure, it's young author, it's books for teenagers, but still, are teenagers never going to be exposed to topics that might be a bit confronting, that might be insensitive to them? What is going to happen to these people when they get out in the world? Or is this what we're seeing now with these university students demanding safe spaces, with them getting post-traumatic or claiming to get post-traumatic stress disorder from listening to lectures? How are they ever going to be challenged? Both Jackson and Zhang are people of color. Who cares? Who now see their careers hobbled in an industry that claimed to be laser-focused on diversity. Jackson has already been dropped from the lineup in at least one literary festival, though it's not clear if he withdrew or was ousted. To risk stating the obvious, books can take years to write, unlike, say, a reporter who writes a clunker of a piece, an author can't simply pop back onto the scene with a new piece of content in a few days or months. Good point. And the industry as a whole is still extremely, extremely white. A survey of book publishing employees in 2016 found that 82% of editorial department employees are white, just 2% are black. Now, I wonder what the ratio of publishers and printers are. Maybe in Asian countries where a lot of books are printed, much cheaper than in Western countries. What's the race profile there? Oh boy, it all comes back to identity politics, doesn't it? A reckoning with these abysmal numbers and their impact is overdue within book publishing. Instead, we've gotten an increasingly toxic online culture around young author literature, with ever more baroque standards for who can write about whom under what circumstances. From the outside, this is starting to look like a conversation focused less on literature and more on obedience. Yes, it is. It is, from someone looking at the outside. It is. This is the social justice book burning, the digital equivalent of a book burning, I would say. In his statement, Jackson invoked his young readership by mentioning the responsibility that comes with introducing readers to certain topics. Young readers are frequently invoked as potential victims of bad young author fiction or young adult. Let me know in the comments if I'm buggering that up. But although teenagers are known to be extremely online, they do not tend to participate publicly in the skirmishes over whether they can handle stories with blurry moral lessons, questionable plot twists, or problematic protagonists. Meanwhile, a 2012 study found that 55% of young adult readers are adults. 55% are adults. Okay, so they're grown up. A percentage, I suspect, has risen since then. I lamented this trend back in 2014 in an essay that made me an enemy of YA Twitter along a different fault line. I would blame Harry Potter, to be honest. This is a conversation among adults about books that are written by adults are largely read by adults, shredding each other's reputations under the guise of protecting the children. Oh, well. None of this has to do with whether Jackson's book is any good, or even in good taste. I haven't read it. But it was written by an author exquisitely attuned to identity issues and presumably vetted by his agent, the staff of a publishing house, and other early readers, including some who have now turned against it, of course. Of course they have. Yes, plenty of books make it that far and then sell poorly or are savaged by critics after publication, but a landscape in which a handful of online critics can hound an author into retracting her own work is something much more foreboding, and hardly one in which new and genuinely interesting voices are likely to thrive. A tagline for Jackson's now dead A Place for Wolves put it, "The only rule, survive. How you do that, up to you." Well, let's have a look at this hashtag. Okay, I've got it here on Twitter. We'll go Own Voices and we'll have a look. Let's just get a feel for what this hashtag is pushing. And I don't know who any of these people are. You know, A Woman Is No Man, a novel. School graders discussing diversity literature. Virtue is purity until marriage. Oh, here it's just exactly what you would all expect, you know, visiting the National Museum of African American History. So, okay, guys, this is own voices. This is the community. What do you think? Is it just desserts? Is this a sign that there is a problem in this community? I think there is. I think it's shocking. And I don't know how to combat this. Maybe this is just how people learn that their communities aren't supportive, because all normal people will start self-publishing. And until Amazon starts, you know, removing everyone from their platform, there's still an opportunity there. Hell, people will even start selling PDFs on their websites. It'll happen. So I think this is just desserts. In a way, I think it's a bit disgusting and a sign of the times. But guys, please let me know what you think in the comments. Like, share, and subscribe. Ding the bell. And for March, I'm going to try and do a morning, a coffee video, and a night video. Let's see how that goes. Take care. Bye for now.